Hello, and welcome to another installment of Sabbath service for May the 15th, 2021. My name is Pastor John Redlich, and I'm the pastor of the Prineville Seventh-day Adventist Church in Prineville, Oregon. Whether you're a friend of the ministry, whether you are a member of my church, whether you've just come across this video while surfing the net, everyone is welcome to view the video and to worship the Lord. May the 15th. It's hard to believe that we are in the middle of the month of May. Time flies, doesn't it? But here we are. Spring has certainly sprung here in Central Oregon, and I hope that you are enjoying nice weather wherever you might happen to be found. As we begin our service today, I would like you to invite you to bow your heads with me as we ask for the Lord's presence as we worship Him. Heavenly Father, we do thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to worship you. We pray that our worship here today would be completely and wholly acceptable in your sight. I pray, Heavenly Father, for everyone that is watching. I pray for myself. I pray that we will be bestowed upon by the Holy Spirit, and that together, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, we will worship you, Lord, in power and truth. I pray, dear Heavenly Father, for this great blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. Our offering today is for the local church budget. As you understand, as I have shared with you before, the local church budget goes to support the various ministries of the church. It also goes to support the physical plant of the church. Even during times of COVID, if you are not able to attend the church that you belong to or attend the church that you regularly attend, the church still has expenses. And the church is still going forward in ministry in various different and unique ways. Even though we can't attend church in person in many cases, luckily here in Prineville we can, but even though many people cannot attend church, it is still an opportunity for us to worship the Lord by returning our tithes and our offerings. And this week, like I said, the offering is for the local church budget, and the church still has expenses as we move forward during this time of uncertainty. I hope that you will return your tithes and offerings faithfully. If you attend a church in person, just bring your offering and your tithe to church and put it in the offering plate as the deacons pass by. If you cannot attend a church, but you are a member of a church, I would certainly encourage you to return your tithe and your offerings in two different ways. Either you can write a check and pop it in the mail and send it to your local church treasurer, or you can get on to AdventistGiving.org. If you sign up as an online giver, it's very convenient and very easy. You don't have to worry about sending anything in the mail. And your donation, your tithe, and your offerings is deducted directly from your credit card or from your bank account. Whatever means that you choose to return tithe and offerings unto the Lord, I pray that God will richly bless you as you worship Him in this manner. Would you join me as we bow our heads and ask for God's blessing upon this week's tithe and offering? Heavenly Father, I pray that you will take the tithe and the offering that has been given this week, that you will multiply it, Lord, and that you will send it along to its intended use. Wish to especially pray for the church budgets of the local churches. During this time of uncertainty, Lord, I pray that you will miraculously multiply the offering that is received, so that the churches, whether they're meeting in person or whether they're not, maybe they're meeting virtually, whatever their situation might be, so that the churches might have the funds to move forward in their ministry. Please bless those that have been able to give this week. And please bless those that, for circumstances unknown, are not able to give this week. Nonetheless, Heavenly Father, take these monies, multiply them to your use. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, returning tithe and offerings is a great blessing, and it's an opportunity to worship the Lord in a very tangible way. And so I hope that you participate in returning your tithe and your offerings as well. Our scripture reading for today, if you want to pull out your devices or your hard copy Bible, our scripture reading for today comes from the book of Joel. Joel is right after the book of Hosea in the Old Testament. Joel chapter 2 and verses 15 to 17. Joel chapter 2 and verses 15 to 17. I'm going to be reading from the King James Version of the Bible, Joel chapter 2 and verses 15 through 17. And this is what the Lord says. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people, sanctify the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children, and those that suck the breast. Let the bridegroom go forth of his chamber, and the bride out of her closet. Let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep between the porch and the altar. Let them say, spare thy people, O Lord, and give not thine heritage to reproach, that the heathen should rule over them. Wherefore should they say among the people, where is their God? May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his holy word today. As I begin my sermon for this week, I'd like to bow my heads and invite you to join me as I ask for God's blessing upon my words. Great Father in heaven, you have called me to be the preacher this week. And Heavenly Father, I am unworthy. But nonetheless, Father, I pray that since you have called me, that you will enable me, that you will give me gifts from on high to preach the word today to your glory and honor. I pray that this sermon might touch the hearts of many, and I pray, Heavenly Father, that your name would be glorified and your kingdom would be magnified. Hide this preacher behind the shadow of a cross. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. My sermon today is entitled, Where is Your God? Where is your God? If you are a Seventh-day Adventist, you will probably enjoy a little bit of the history lesson that is going to be in the sermon today. If you're not a Seventh-day Adventist, you'll probably enjoy to hear about the roots of the Seventh-day Adventist Church as well. So whoever you are, I'm sure that this will be a blessing for you. Seventh-day Adventists are doctrinal heirs to the Millerite movement in the early 1840s. The Millerite movement and the Adventist movement, not the Seventh-day Adventist movement, but the Adventist movement. See, the Millerites taught that Jesus was coming soon, very soon. And so they were also considered Adventists. As a matter of fact, anybody that is looking forward to the soon return of Jesus Christ is an Adventist. We were also heirs, doctrinal heirs, to many other spiritual awakenings that were occurring around the world at that time. The Millerites were experiencing a great explosion of interest in North America, and especially the United States. But around the world at this time, there was a great spiritual awakening happening as well. Much of this spiritual awakening had a deep interest in the second coming of Jesus Christ. Now, the Seventh-day Adventist Church did not formally organize until the year 1860 to 1863. However, since 1844, a distinct and well-formed body of believers had developed. And this body of believers that had developed became what is known as today the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Of course, many of us are very familiar with the names of the pioneers of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Of course, there is Ellen G. White, there is Joseph Bates, there is James White, J.N. Andrews. Many of these names are very well known amongst the members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. It was under the leadership of individuals like this who were inspired by the Holy Spirit that scattered groups of Sabbatarian Adventists, people that were awaiting the second coming of Jesus Christ and who worshiped on the Sabbath, began the movement that is known as the Seventh-day Adventist Church today. These groups started pulling together, started forming together. And from these groups, differences were resolved, and the main outline of doctrines held in common was laid down. Thus, the beginning of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, long before the doctrinal name or the formal name was developed and adopted. You know, the name Seventh-day Adventist was not adopted until 1860, and the General Conference of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, the governing body of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, was not established until 1863. So in these humble beginnings of people studying the Word and trying to find out what the truth of the Bible was, and Sabbatarian groups joining together, Adventist groups joining together, from these humble beginnings and the development of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, ministries were established that made it a worldwide organization. These ministries included medical ministry and health ministry, publishing houses to publish documents and to publish periodicals and books to share with members and to share with those that were not members. Foreign missions was established as the early Seventh-day Adventist Church sent missionaries to other parts of the world to share the message. Domestic evangelism was established. Foreign evangelism was established. Can you imagine being part of the church in those early days? The church was a vibrant, alive organization. And as things were developing and as things were coming together, it became obvious that God's miraculous hand was pulling everything together and forming the Seventh-day Adventist Church. There must have been an energy buzzing around amongst the members of the early Seventh-day Adventist Church. One of the things that was very common in the early Adventist Church was the study of the Bible. The Bible was studied on a regular basis. Not just a cursory study, but a very in-depth study as the church continued to grow and develop. Seventh-day Adventist members and ministers and evangelists that could not debate with anyone concerning the doctrines of the Seventh-day Adventist Church were simply non-existent. These new Adventists were a peculiar people. They dressed differently. They ate different food. They preached a unique message, not only about the Sabbath, but other doctrinal issues such as the sanctuary and the midnight cry. The early Seventh-day Adventist members developed a reputation. They were called the people of the book because of their unwavering dependence on Scripture as their ultimate source of authority. During the early years of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, if questions on doctrine would arise and could not easily be answered, our pioneers would stop. They would pray earnestly, and then they would begin studying the Bible, sometimes hours on end, sometimes well into the night, and even overnight. They would study the Bible to see what the Word of God said on a particular question that was at hand. And they would continue studying the Bible until the answer became very clear from the Scriptures, the answer to their question on the doctrine. The early church was on fire for the Lord. They were riding the horse of righteousness to heaven, and King Jesus was leading the way. But because Seventh-day Adventists were a peculiar people, Sabbatarian Christians, they were also the target of some ridicule, religious insults. They were called Jews. They were called vegetarian Christians. You know, as I have studied the history of the Seventh-day Adventist Church through my career, nowhere, even though insults were cast upon members and ministers of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, nowhere have I ever noticed anyone ask one specific question of our pioneers. They called us names. They debated with our early ministers and evangelists. Some joined the ranks of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and some left the ranks of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. But nowhere have I ever come across a documented case. Maybe it exists out there, but I've never seen it. Nowhere have I ever come across a documented case where somebody was accusing a church member, a minister, an evangelist, or even accusing the Seventh-day Adventist Church by asking the question, "Where is your God?" Meaning, you might have a church, but it is not backed up by God. The implication is clear. You might say that you're religious, you might say that you're a Christian, but I don't see the power of God in your church. I don't see the power of God in your life. I don't see the truth of your doctrine. Nowhere have I ever come across any documented case of somebody saying to our pioneers, "Where is your God?" Not only did the early pioneers have a form of godliness, but they also had his power as well. The church spread like wildfire, and Satan, well, he trembled. He trembled. In the magazine Signs of the Times, May 9th, 1878, it says this: "The history of the Jews was written for our benefit, upon whom the ends of the world are come, that we should not murmur as they did, that we should not be filled with ambition and pride as they were, that we should avoid their example of wrongdoing and not fall as they fell. In the sacred word of God, the history of Israel is spread out before us for our instruction." Okay. So what was the history of Israel in relationship to their connection and their commitment to follow God? Well, most of us, we are very familiar with the history of the Jewish nation. But as a reminder, can you please turn with me to Genesis chapter 12 and verses 1 to 4? Genesis chapter 12, and we're going to verses 1 and 4. Genesis chapter 12 and verses 1 through 4, talking about the history of the Israelite nation. Now the Lord has said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will shew thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curseth thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken unto him. And Lot went with him, and Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. A very familiar story of Abraham being called by God to get out of his country, to follow God to an unknown country, and the promise of God that through Abram there would be a great nation and that all the earth would be blessed as a result of him. Abram, and he later became known as Abraham, was the very first Jew, as it were, and he was obedient to God. A God who had never revealed himself to Abraham before tells him to leave his home and to follow him. And Abraham does it. Talk about faith. Talk about obedience. Well, the children of Israel are off to a good start. Now let's go to Genesis chapter 12 and verses 11 to 13. Genesis chapter 12 and verses 11 to 13. And it came to pass, when he was come near to enter into Egypt, that he said unto Sarai his wife, behold now, I know that thou art a fair woman to look upon. Therefore it shall come to pass, when the Egyptians shall see thee, that they shall say, this is his wife, and they will kill me, but they will save thee alive. Say, I pray thee, thou art my sister, that it may be well with me for thy sake, and my soul shall live because of thee. Well, it didn't take Abram, also known as Abraham, long, did it? You know the story. You might be very familiar with this story. In the very same chapter where he is called out of his home to go into a land and to produce a nation that would bless the entire earth, in the very same chapter, he commits sin by instructing his wife to lie, then holding the truth from the Pharaoh that takes Sarai to be his wife. Does the story of Israel end there? Abram failed, and failed miserably. As you follow his life, though, you discover that he repents of his sin, and he is called a righteous man by God in the Scriptures. That's a great lesson for us, isn't it? Us sinners, and I'm presuming that, of course, that everybody is a sinner. I don't have to presume. I understand that we are all sinners. A great lesson for us sinners that even though we may sin, even willfully sin, as Abraham did here, even though we may sin, we can find forgiveness from God if we repent and confess our sin. The story of Israel is a lesson book for us living in the end times. Now, I can't find anything in Scripture where anybody asked Abram or Abraham, "Where is your God?" Seems to me that Abraham not only had a form of godliness, but he had the power of godliness as well. And Satan trembled. Let's jump ahead to Moses, shall we? Let's go to the book of Exodus, chapter 19. Exodus, chapter 19, and we're going to verses 3 and 8. 3 to 8. Exodus, chapter 19, and verses 3 to 8. And Moses went up to God, and the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, "Thus shalt thou say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bare you on eagle's wings and brought you unto myself. Now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. There are words which thou shalt speak. These are words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel." And Moses came and called for the elders of the people and laid before their faces all these words which the Lord commanded him. Verse 8. And all the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord hath spoken, we will do." And Moses returned the words of the people unto the Lord. An amazing story of the children of Israel consecrating themselves before the Lord. They had just been released from slavery, from 400 years of slavery. Egypt's army had just been destroyed and crushed and drowned in the Red Sea. Not one Israelite lost their lives as they crossed the Red Sea. On a spiritual high, Israel accepts God's offer to be their God, and they will be his people. They promise to do whatever, everything that God commands, and they will take the message of the Lord to the world. Talk about devotion. Talk about spiritual power. Not only was there a form of godliness, but there was power in the children of Israel as a result of this experience. Fast forward to Exodus chapter 32. Exodus chapter 32 and verses 1 through 4. Exodus chapter 32 and verses 1 through 4. And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron, and said unto him, "Up, make us gods, which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what is become of him." And Aaron said unto them, "Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, of your sons, and of your daughters, and bring them unto me." And all the people brake off the golden earrings which were in their ears, and brought them to Aaron. And he received them at their hand and fashioned it with a graving tool after he had made it a molten calf. And they said, "These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt." First of all, they had it wrong, right from the beginning, that it was Moses that had brought them out of the land of Egypt. It was God that had brought them out of the land of Egypt. And so by turning their eyes off of God and onto the man Moses, and when he delayed, when he was up on the mountain talking with God, they decided that they should make an idol, a golden calf, and that they should worship this calf, and that it was actually the calf that brought them out of the land of Egypt rather than the God of the universe. Talk about blasphemy. It wasn't the God, it wasn't the calf that had saved them. It was God that had saved them. But the story of Israel doesn't end there. God did not smite the Egyptians completely as a result of their sin. God tells Moses, who is up on the mountain, what's going on down there in the camp of the Israelites. And he tells them that he's planning on destroying them. He didn't destroy them immediately, and I think that God had a purpose in offering Moses an opportunity to intercede for the nation, for the children of Israel. And so Moses, he intercedes. He prays. He asks God for a favor. He asks God to forgive them. He also says to God, "Let it be me that dies rather than them." God's heart accepts the petition of Moses, and God forgives the Israelite people for what they are doing. Moses descends from the mountain and asks the people to repent. Those that repented were saved, and those that did not, well, they were slain. The story of Israel is indeed a lesson book for us living in the end times. As the children of Israel continued their wanderings and finally crossed over the Jordan to Jericho, the people in their path did not ask of them, "Where is your God?" For their wanderings for 40 years in the wilderness had taught the children of Israel to rely completely on God and not to rely on themselves or some silly little image that they might put together. They were truly God's nation at the time. And Satan, he trembled. The Bible is full of experiences, full of examples of how Israel falls away from the Lord, repents, and is forgiven. The scriptures are full of marvelous ways that God worked in and for the children of Israel. What a wonderful God God is, in that if we should sin, we have an advocate in heaven who will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The history of Israel is plain that God is willing to do that. And as Israel's experience was one of up and down, as the story of Israel goes on, when God's people were devoted to him, the power of God was unmistakably in their midst. But when they strayed from God, what did people say? People said, "Where is your God?" They would say that to the children of Israel because Well, they saw a form of godliness, but they saw no power. The book of Joel, from where came our scripture reading here this morning, is just another time when Israel falls away from God. The message is sent to the children of Israel through the prophet Joel. And the message is a message, as it has many times before been to the children of Israel. The message is a message of repentance. Turn away from your evil ways, your sinful ways, and return unto me. As you read the book of Joel, it doesn't say in the book of Joel what the sins of Israel were. I can only imagine that the sins of Israel were once again returning to idol worship and Baal worship as Israel had done so many times before. But nonetheless, the message of Joel, if you read through the book of Joel, is one of repentance. Turn from your wicked ways. In any event, God says and sends them a message through the prophet Joel. Let's go to Joel chapter 1 and verses 1 to 12 and then verse 15. Joel chapter 1, verses 1 to 12 and then verse 15. The word of the Lord came to Joel, the son of Pethuel. Hear this, ye old men, and give ear, all ye inhabitants of the land. Hath this been in your days, or even in the days of your fathers? Tell ye your children of it, and let your children tell their children, and their children another generation. That which the palmer worm hath left hath the locust eaten, and that which the locust hath left hath the canker worm eaten, and that which the canker worm hath left hath the caterpillar eaten. Awake, ye drunkards, and weep, and howl, all ye drinkers of wine, because of the new wine, for it is cut off from your mouth. For a nation has come up upon thy land, strong and without number, whose teeth are the teeth of a lion, and he hath the cheek teeth of a great lion. He hath laid my vine waste, and hath barked my fig tree. He hath made it clean bare, and cast it away. The branches thereof are made white. Lament like a virgin girded with sackcloth for the husband of her youth. The meat offering and the drink offering is cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests, the Lord's ministers, mourn. The field is wasted, the land mourneth, for the corn is wasted. The new wine is dried up, the oil languisheth. Be ye ashamed, O ye husbandmen, howl, O ye vine dressers, for the wheat and for the barley, because the harvest of the field is perished. The vine is dried up, and the fig tree languisheth. The pomegranate tree, the palm tree also, and the apple tree, even all the trees of the field are withered, because joy is withered away from the sons of men. Verse 15, alas for the day of the Lord is at hand, and as a destruction from the Almighty shall it come. Very interesting description of the sin that was in the Israelite nation at this time. The fields would not give their harvest. That which was harvested was eaten by worms. Trees withered and died. They were overtaken by a nation represented by lion and sharp lion's teeth. All this was, of course, metaphoric of what was going on in the nation of Israel. Again, we don't know what their exact sin was, but we do recognize the description of the Lord. And we do recognize that he was not very pleased with the children of Israel at this time. But all is not lost. After warning the children of Israel at this time, God then offers them a way out. He then offers them a way out. He says to the children of Israel, people, take this seriously. Joel chapter 2 and verses 12 to 13. Joel chapter 2 and verses 12 to 13. Therefore also now saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart. God's offering them a way out. And with mourning, and rend your heart, and not your garments, and turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness, and repenteth him of the evil. God's offering them a way out. He's saying, come on, take this seriously. You are my people. You are involved in great sin, but I will forgive you. Just turn back to me. Then Joel chapter 2 and verse 15 through 17. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Sanctify a fast. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the people. Sanctify the congregation. Assemble the elders. Gather the children and those that suck at the breast of the Let the bridegroom go forth of his chamber and the bride out of her closet. Let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep between the porch and the altar, and let them say, spare thy people, O Lord, and give not thine inheritance to reproach, that the heathen should rule over them. Wherefore should they say among the people, where is your God? Israel, I want to be your God. But if you continue in your sinful ways, there will be no power. There will be a form of godliness, but there will be no power. And people will recognize that in the nation of Israel, and they will jest at you. And they will say, where is your God? Where is this God that brought you out of the land of Egypt? The story of Israel is indeed a lesson book for us living in the last days. The story of Joel continues and reveals that God intends to restore Israel, to destroy her enemies, and work so miraculously that even the Jews themselves will know that God is in their midst. However, this conditional promise will never see its fulfillment in literal Israel. Finally and forever, Israel turned away from God when they proclaimed, we have no king but Caesar. And this time, Satan was happy. But since that day, in the first century, things turned around. Since that day when the Jews proclaimed that they had no king but Caesar, they were saying, God in heaven is not our king. We proclaim our commitment and our loyalty to Caesar. Jesus gave himself on the cross. The Christian church was born. Believers in Christ, no matter their blood heritage, became the sons and daughters of Abraham, heirs to the promise. People repented of their sins. People gave their lives to and for Jesus. God once again had his church on this earth. God, down through the ages, has preserved his church. There has always been a remnant. And then one day, a little group of Sabbatarian Christians said, "We'll preach the truth. We will bridge the gap. We will sound the midnight cry." And once again, Satan trembled. And as I've said before, and to that little group, to my knowledge, no one has ever said, "Where is your God?" Let me ask you a question. Are we the same today as that little Sabbatarian group of Christians in the mid-1800s? Are we still called people of the book? Are we still a peculiar people? Or do we wish to be like everybody else? Are we still studying the Bible to make sure that we are following the revealed will of God? Or have we turned to idols, false gods, false doctrine, and strange fire, as the Jews did? The Jews finally lost their way as God's chosen people. By God's grace, let us turn from our wicked ways and live. By God's grace, let us be a royal priesthood. By God's grace, let us be a peculiar people. Even if people call us names. By God's grace, let us be his children and he be our God, and let his Shekinah glory be in our midst once again. Let them call us veggie Christians. Let them call us old-fashioned. Let them tell us that we're stuck in the past and that we have not progressed enough in our understanding of God. Let them call us old-fashioned and out of date. But heaven forbid, let them never ask us, "Where is your God?" Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for this time of worship that you have given us. Father, we need to repent of our wicked ways and turn to you. We need to confess our sins. We need to seek our wisdom and understanding from your scriptures. We need to apply your scriptures to our lives. And we need to be your peculiar people, your royal priesthood, to bring the message of Jesus Christ and him crucified to the world while there is still time. And so, Father, I pray that all of us will consider confession and repentance and turn from our wicked ways and live. And now pray, Father, that your arm of safety and security and salvation and prosperity and health would encircle each and every one of us. Grant us the privilege of once again worshiping together, or may we be found around the tree of life. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for tuning in to this installment of Sabbath service. I hope that you were blessed. I hope that you were challenged. Whoever you are, wherever you are, I hope that you are blessed this week. In Jesus' name, amen.